died so we might live. Amen. The text will serve as the base of our message for this morning in our gospel lesson from St. Matthew, chapter 13, verses 44 to 52. Dear friends in Christ, how often do you need encouraging words? Do you need to be built up? Do you want some comfort? You know, the disciples certainly needed it at times. They were following a man whose popularity was growing and growing. Healing people, casting out demons, teaching with authority, the crowds got bigger. Jesus was getting many likes on Facebook. You know, actually, face to face. But then the teaching of Jesus gets more challenging. He was calling for a change in worship and commitment. Jesus challenged the church leaders and how they used their positions for power and money. That brought a different reaction. The Facebook crowd didn't like him as much, and they told him so. The crowds are hostile and smaller. Resistance to Jesus was becoming threatening. Can you imagine the disciples' reaction? What's going on here? The crowds are supposed to be bigger. What if the Romans start showing their muscle? The disciples were feeling vulnerable. Did we sign up for this? Discouraged, confused, afraid. The disciples needed some encouragement and some comforting words. Do you ever feel this way? Is it supposed to be this way as a follower of Jesus? An article in the Wall Street Journal says that Christianity is the most persecuted faith in the world. As most of us know, in Muslim countries, Christians are second-class citizens. Churches are burned. Pastors and priests are arrested and beaten. Now, it isn't that bad as yet in the United States, but you can feel the shift. In college classes, professors attack what we believe. Jesus' name is systematically removed from everyday life. The concept of family and marriage, as defined by our Creator, is taking a beating. Life sanctity, abortions continue. The old who are dying are treated as a number, a statistic. It is all so discouraging. The Barna Group did a survey on the most post-Christian cities in America. These are communities who don't believe in God, have not attended church, believe that Jesus had sinned, all this, etc. Now, not surprising, in the top 10, we find the usual suspects. Portland, Maine. Boston, Massachusetts. San Francisco, California. Seattle, Washington. But tucked in this top 10 list at number 55 is Champaign, Springfield, Decatur. At 35% post-Christian. Guess who lives in the middle of that triangle? You and I. That's disturbing. Our churches are losing members. The pews have less people on a Sunday morning. And more people are saying they do not have a religious affiliation. That's hard to take. We certainly feel like the disciples did back then. We are confused. We are discouraged. It's not supposed to be this way. We need a word of encouragement. We need a word of comfort. So Jesus tells the disciples and us two parables. A man finds a treasure in a field and gives up everything to buy that field. A man finds a precious pearl. He gives up everything to buy that pearl. Now, Who is the man? Who is the treasure? Well, we know we can't buy our way into God's presence. So the man is Jesus. He will give up everything, including his place in glory and his power and prestige to be born into this world. He will give up his safety to complete his mission. He will give up his life. He will give up everything for the precious pearl, the treasure. Know what that means? The disciples are the treasure in Jesus' eyes. They are the pearl that he's willing to give up everything for. So we too are the treasure in Jesus' eyes. Jesus tells these parables to give us encouragement and comfort. We have dignity because he formed us in our mother's womb. Jesus treats every person with total sanctity of life. And he's going to sort out things at the end of time. Those who have persecuted the church are going to find out who is Lord of all. Those who have done evil in his name will learn that their works did not please him. But for those who are faithful to the end, he will rejoice in his glory as he comes back for us. What's your favorite comfort food? Chocolate? Mac and cheese? Beef? In the church, Jesus gives the ultimate comfort food when we go to the Lord's table. His body and blood given and shed for us, we eat this comfort food. And we know he has risen from dead and he is alive, working his salvation in our lives. Some people like to use water to feel better. A hot shower. A hot tub. Hydrotherapy. Vacation on a beach. We have water too, the baptismal water. Jesus came to us and said, "You are mine. I gave everything for you." Now that's encouraging. That's comforting. There are times we need the words of encouragement and comfort, something to reassure us that despite what we see happening in the world and in the country and in the church, Jesus still sees us as pearls of great price. Listen to these passages. "But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. But now, says the Lord, he who created you, O Jacob, he who formed you, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine." Sometimes you need to be built up. Sometimes you just need comfort. Today you've heard it. We are Jesus' treasure. He gives up everything for us. And now Jesus provides the comforting words we need.